for being here in this event. I would like to talk about the international context. I think we need to remember that until 1991, the enemy by global superpowers or global powers in the West were fundamentally conceived as the communist bloc. There was a lot of investment in keeping the enemy as the communist. In the USA, there is the what is known as the military industrial complex. For those who doesn't know about it, is private enterprises who produce military weapons. And part of the way they made their profits is by selling these weapons to the Defense Department of the USA. And they cannot go to a mall or to a supermarket to sell these weapons. They have, they're forced to have contracts with the government to be able to sell the weapons they produce, the bombs, military airplanes, tanks, and so on. While the communist threat was there, there was, let's put it this way, in the eyes or, you know, facing the American public opinion, there was a consensus to justify those military budgets with the argument of the communist threat. So you have a very strong lobby in Washington that is linked to these corporations that basically live off warfare, not welfare. This is what is called in the USA corporate welfare. That is companies that live off contracts of the government. We have a research project at the University of California, Berkeley, in the Center for Race and Gender on the questions related to Islamophobia. It's the Islamophobia Research Project, and we have a journal, the Islamophobia, it's called Journal of Islamophobia Studies, and we publish twice a year volumes of this journal, and we organize conferences in different parts of the world, similar to this conference. And I really want to thank the Solidarity Youth Movement as well as the University of Calicut for the invitation, for being here with all of you. And in our research, we try to look at the different aspects related to Islamophobia. And so one of the aspects is this transition from the moment when the communist was the main threat of the West and was the main argument used to justify the military budgets in relation to what I've been describing as corporate welfare. Once the communist bloc disappeared, there is a crisis inside the USA about who is the enemy. And that crisis was manifested inside the Pentagon in the early 90s, when the Soviet Union basically imploded and disappeared. And therefore, the communist threat suddenly disappeared. So the challenge at the moment, especially from the point of view of this military-industrial complex, was how to keep the high levels of U.S. federal government budget invested in the Defense Department in a context where the enemy superpower, no, and the communist threat has disappeared. And so there was a debate in the early 90s about this question, that their interest was not only to keep the budget as high as it was in the early 90s, but the interest was to make it increase significantly in the face of the 21st century. So how do you justify in the eyes of the American public to increase the military budget in such dramatic way if there is no more communist threat? In the early 90s, the debate in the Pentagon was, there were some factions saying that the enemy is China. Of course, if you define the enemy as China, the upper hand of the budget will go to the Air Force. The Pentagon is divided in three branches: the Air Force, the Marines, and the Army. The Air Force in a war against China will be the main actor, because China is a huge country with a lot of population, and there's no way you can fight a war with China relying in only in the Army or with Marines. You need the Air Force there as the main actor. So that will imply that if you define the new enemy as China, the budget of the Defense Department will be fundamentally on the side of the Air Force and the industries related to the Air Force. For example, military airplane industries. So there was a position inside the Pentagon about this question. The Army and the Marines, the Navy, were not happy with this. So there was another theory coming up, which was to define the enemy as the drugs coming from the global south, from Latin America, especially through the sea, crossing the Atlantic, crossing the Caribbean Ocean, or from the Pacific Ocean. And in a situation like that, the upper hand will be in the hands, of course, of the Navy, because in the oceans, the main actor is not the Air Force, it's not the Army, it's the Navy. So there was a debate, and there was opposition to that, because that means that the piece of the pie of the military budget will be concentrated fundamentally on the Navy. Then there was another theory saying that the main enemy are the immigrants crossing the border from the south of the USA, people coming from Mexico and Central America, and that there was a need to militarize the border and all these things. In a situation like that, the great piece of the pie will belong to the Army, not to the Navy or to the Air Force. So there was a big debate and discussion going on in the early 90s, once the Soviet Union fell and disappeared. in terms of who is going to be the new enemy. And this had, whoever the enemy was, it had implications in terms of how the military budget will be distributed and which companies will get the contracts and which branch of the Pentagon will have the upper hand. So the dispute was an internal dispute inside the Pentagon between the Army, the Navy, and the Air Force about who is the new enemy. And they couldn't agree, because whoever the enemy they put there, that would benefit one of the branches as opposed to the other. Here comes a Harvard scholar, University of Harvard, Harvard University, very famous university. This scholar has been linked for a long time to American geopolitical imperial projects, like the Tricontinental, that was a project in the 70s composed fundamentally of transnational corporations. And the Tricontinental, if you remember, were saying that it was justifiable to have right-wing dictatorships and that the USA should promote and support and encourage right-wing dictatorships around the world because there will be an important tool in the struggle against communism. And one of the theoreticians of this theory was Samuel Huntington back in the 70s. Then he makes a comeback in the debate I'm describing to you in the mid-90s. And he comes with first an article, later a book, about the article is Clash of Civilizations. It's a question mark in the article. In the book, there's no question mark. It's Clash of Civilizations. And in this article, and later became a book, the thesis he's going to work with is the thesis that the main enemy at the international scale is not China, is not immigrants coming from the South, is not drug cartels bringing drugs to USA, is the Muslims. And he's going to say that what is going, the future, basically the future is a clash between what he calls Muslim civilization and the West, okay? Of course, to talk about Muslim civilization is, I will say, problematic, because in the past 500 years, if you know a little of history or world history, you know that the European colonial expansion around the world destroyed all the existing civilizations. It destroyed the Aztecs in the Americas. It destroyed the Incas. It began by destroying Islamic civilization in the south of Spain, Al-Andalus. And they went to the Americas with the methods of colonization of Al-Andalus. They used the same methods and extrapolated to the Americas and destroyed the civilizations over there. And they continue expanding until by the end of 19th century, most of the world was already colonized or peripheralized by the West, destroying all the existing civilizations. The last remaining stronghold of that, of alternative civilizations to Western civilization was the Ottomans. And as we know, they were destroyed during the First World War, and the British and the French divided the territory among themselves, creating new identities and later new nation states that did not exist before, including Syria, Iraq, Lebanon, etc. You know, so there are, and of course, there was no Zionist project during the Ottomans. This comes with the British and the French later. So between the two, they divided, split the territory, and create, let's put it this way, national identities under the protectorate and colonial rule of the British and the French, and created what is called today nation states from places where there was no nation state, because the Ottomans have a different form of political authority that was very different from the concept of nation state. But that came out of the destroy of the Ottomans. And so we are, after 1917, we're basically under one planetary civilization. So the talk about clash of civilization is as if there was some civilization that coexists with the West. And I will challenge that thesis, just because there's no other civilization that survived the European colonial expansion. Of course, there are people with culture, spiritualities, epistemologies that are different, but that doesn't mean that there is a civilization. That's a different thing. When we say civilization, we're talking about many things that are not just having culture, spirituality, identities. It's more than that. It's having economic, political, cultural infrastructure, okay? Infrastructure of knowledge production, its institutions, etc., that were destroyed with the European colonial expansion. So today, I will say we live under one planetary civilization, hegemonized by Western imperial powers. And the rest of the world, in one way or another, have been subordinated, peripheralized, colonized, or neo-colonized. And so the thesis, I would say, is a flaw thesis, because I don't think there is a clash of civilization when you don't have more than one civilization existing today. But to continue with the narrative of Huntington, he basically came up and say to the U.S. establishment, stop this nonsense fight about who is the main enemy, you know, because it's going nowhere. Here I have the solution. If you define Muslims as the enemy, there is a piece of the pie for everybody here. And so this was the narrative that in the mid-90s began to be pushed inside US dominant circles about who is the main enemy. If you know a little of US history, in the 19th century, there was, the USA was facing the problem of trying to find ways to turn USA into a superpower for the, that was in the 19th century, they were finding ways to turn USA as a superpower in the 20th century. And there was a naval strategist. His name was Alfred Maham. It's a name that not many people know or remember. Alfred Maham was the naval strategist of the USA in the 19th century. And he was assigned basically to create a strategic plan to make the USA a superpower in the 20th century. And he wrote in the 1880s several seminal books that were very influential among the top political elites of the US at the time. And he basically did a thorough study of the British Empire. trying to find out how the British Empire became a superpower. And I'm not going to give you a lecture about Mahan or about all the details about this because it will take a long time. But to make a long story short, he basically saw the rise of the British in relation to the rise of or the control of the seas, of the oceans, and how the British developed a control of trade routes around the world by putting naval bases in strategic places around the world and controlling trade routes. So it's very long thesis that I cannot go in detail, just very briefly and very simplified. He basically said, well, the USA have to do the same thing. We need to find those strategic locations and put military naval bases there to control trade routes around the world and prepare the USA to become a superpower and follow the model of the British, and sooner or later will displace the British and America will become the superpower. So those books were very important. And he wrote up in one of the book, he said, we need to control basically the passages that goes from east to west. And instead of having the international trade routes going through the Suez Canal, we should build a canal in Panama. So it's one of his points, build a canal in Panama. Panama at the time was a province of a country of South America, Colombia, okay? And he said, we need to also control the trade routes in the Caribbean and in the Pacific. So he said, we need to build military bases in the island of Puerto Rico, naval bases in the island of Puerto Rico, in the island of Cuba, in a place called Guantanamo. We need to put naval base in an island in the Pacific, in the island of Hawaii, in a place called Pearl Harbor. And we need to put naval bases in Samoa Islands, in the Philippines, in Palau Islands, in Mariana Islands, all over the Pacific. So, to make a long story short, he was naming the places where the USA has to put naval bases to control trade routes and to shift the trade between east and west instead of going through the Suez Canal, going through the Panama Canal. So the problem that they faced when he was writing these books was that all these places did not belong to the USA at the time he was writing the books. Panama was a province of Colombia. Puerto Rico, Cuba, Philippines, Samoa Islands, Guam Island, Palau Islands, all of these were territories of a declining empire in the 19th century, Spain. And Hawaii was a Pacific Islander territory. So the question was how to implement the plan in a context where you don't control any of these territories. How are you going to go about controlling the territories? So usually you have an imperial strategist like Mahan developing a strategy, but the actors, the people who implement the strategy, are usually politicians who come to power in the US administration and are the ones implementing usually these plans that are prepared with years ahead. So the question for Mahan was not how to implement the plan. That's a question for other people to figure it out. The question for him was to prepare the plan, to vision, have a vision of what to do, and then other people will find ways to do it. So the problem was, most of these territories belong to Spain. How do you go in a war against Spain, which is a declining empire, if Spain is not interested in attacking you? How do you do that? How do you justify war against Spain and take over all these territories and try to implement the plan? Here comes 1898, the Spanish-American War. And it happened that a naval ship of the USA was in Havana Harbor in Cuba. Havana Harbor, it was there, stationed there. And it exploded, and 220 Marines died. So to make a long story short, Theodore Roosevelt, who was at the time the subsecretary of the War Department of the USA, and whose master thesis in Harvard in 1892 is entitled Alfred Mahan, for anybody who have a doubt about if he was following Mahan or not, his master thesis in Harvard was Alfred Mahan. So he was following exactly what Alfred Mahan was proposing. So Theodore Roosevelt basically, after the implosion, I'm saying implosion because that ship imploded from within. That ship was never attacked by Spain. But the Theodore Roosevelt and the U.S. state at the time accused Spain of having attacked the ship. And with this, they justify going into a war against Spain and taking over all the remaining colonies of the Spanish Empire from the Caribbean all the way to the Pacific. And it happened that they went after exactly the same places that Mahan has pointed in his books years before. Since 1910, American Historical Association officially recognized that the Maine was the name of that naval ship that exploded in the Havana Harbor, was never attacked by Spain. The Maine imploded from within, killing 220 Marines. So I'm mentioning this because there's several instances in U.S. history where USA have used the excuse of someone is attacking us to go into war against someone else and basically implement the plan that have been conceived before by some imperial strategists. Second World War, everybody knows, because it's public documentation too, that the USA provoked the attack of the Japanese in Pearl Harbor, that they knew the time, day, and everything when the Japanese were going to attack, and they allowed the attack to come, and they provoked the attack by putting all the naval ships there, sending signals of aggression to Japan, and Japan sent telegrams. That's what we know today, that U.S. elites knew the attack because Japan have sent telegrams to U.S. elites saying, these ships, what are they doing in Pearl Harbor, Hawaii? So are they coming to attack us? I mean, we take it as a declaration of war, you know? So they sent telegrams and there was no response. Finally, Japanese sent a telegram saying the day and the time they were going to attack Pearl Harbor. So they knew the attack was coming. And the political elites of USA did nothing because they needed the attack to justify going into Second World War. And so that attack happened in 1941, and 2,000 Marines died that day. They could have prevented that because they knew the attack was coming. They knew the day, the time, everything. 1961, there was the conflict with Cuba, and there are papers declassified in the Pentagon where Pentagon generals were talking about blowing up a civilian airplane to justify going into a war against Cuba and accuse Cuba of having destroy the civilian airplane with Americans inside the airplane. That never happened and never materialized, basically because at the time, John F. Kennedy was the president of the United States and he opposed doing this. 1967, six days war of Arab countries with the Zionist state. And there was a situation in which a naval ship of USA, that was an intelligence ship, was running through Mediterranean waters close to Egypt and the Zionist state. And that boat was attacked by the Zionists. They killed 72 Marines. The boat was sinking in the Mediterranean. And the idea was that by attacking that boat, sinking it in the Mediterranean, USA will accuse Egypt of having done it, and then justify the intervention of USA against Egypt in the middle of the war of Arab countries with the Zionist state. That happened in 1967. And there are, the evidence have come out. There are witnesses of the boat that come out in a documentary now talking about this, what happened. The problem was that the war did not last more than 6 days, and so there was no time for USA to declare war against Egypt. And guess who saved the boat from sinking in the Mediterranean? It was the Egyptian government at the time who took it to the Alexandria port and avoided more people from dying. But 72 Marines died by the attack of the Zionists. And of course, they threat all the survivors to keep silence about what has happened. To keep silence, not say anything, in the name of national security. What was the Zionist government attacking this ship and trying to sink it, an American boat? Well, it happened that there was some kind of coordination there to justify the sinking of this boat to go and attack so that USA can justify attacking Egypt in the middle of this six-day war between Egypt and other Arab countries with the Zionist state. And the attack came from the Zionists. I can go on. 1981, the invasion of Granada. Very similar story. They claim that students were under security threats. There was an American university in Granada. There was a revolutionary government in Granada. And they used as an excuse that the students were under threat, et cetera, to go and invade Granada. 1989, the invasion of Panama. And they used, there were US Marines using uniforms of the Panamanian government and attacking US military bases in Panama to justify, in the eyes of the American public opinion, attacking and invading Panama. So there is a history. If you know history in the USA, there is a history of USA planning attack to certain places and finding ways to justify it in the eyes of public opinion by creating false flag operations. False flag operations. So the problem with Huntington in writing Clash of Civilization, defining the Muslims as the enemy, was the same problem of Alfred Mahan in the 19th century, okay, of calling for taking over all the remaining colonies of the Spanish Empire. And the problem was that the same way as the Spanish Empire had never attacked USA and never have attacked the USA, The problem was that the same way Spanish Empire never attacked USA and have no interest in attacking USA, there was no situation where they could claim Muslims were attacking USA. And there was no interest at the time of anybody or anybody from the Muslim world attacking USA. So at that moment, the challenge was, one thing is the plan, another thing is how you implement the plan and how you justify implementing the plan in the eyes of the public opinion, okay? So here comes September 11. And they're telling me the time is over, but I don't have time. I can be 2 hours talking about September 11 and what happened that day, but I don't have the time, just to say that they use similar thing they have used in other previous wars of false flag operations to justify an attack in US, you know, an attack against Muslim countries, okay? And to justify the thesis of clash of civilization of Huntington. And in the name of the struggle against Islamic terrorism. So now the new enemy are the Muslims, and now they're going to justify by using the September 11, attacks inside US territory as the justification to now declare war against Muslim countries and invade Afghanistan first and later Iraq and begin a whole plan of surveilling Muslims at a world scale and begin a whole plan of stripping citizens from civil and democratic rights in the name of anti-terror laws, okay? So you have the elimination of basic civil and citizenship rights in the USA, in Britain, in France, in Belgium, in many countries of the West. They're not only using the Islamic terrorist threat, quote unquote, to justify the military, the escalation in the military budget, and now everybody in the Pentagon is happy because the three branches are getting one third of the pie. And when you talk about the new enemy as Islamic terrorism, that's a never ending war. That could last anytime they want because there's no boundaries to this discourse about Islamic terrorism or the war on terror. I mean, there's no beginning nor end. They can use it all the time they want to justify, keep increasing the military budgets. If you look at the military budget of the USA, it has triplicated since the early 90s when the Soviet Union was there. And now it eats up more than 50% of the federal budget of the USA. So they have been successful at using this to increase the military budget, keep happy the three branches of the Pentagon, keep happy the military industrial complex that now have contracts after contracts after contracts, while killing millions of people out there, okay? And the other aspect is domestically using the threat of the Islamic terrorism to strip citizens from their rights and move into extreme right neo-fascist regimes where now democracy, citizenship rights, civil rights are at stake right now inside the West. But once the West begins to do these things, then you have the photocopy happening elsewhere. And the photocopy, you could see it in many regimes in the third world, neo-colonial regimes in the third world, exacerbating the so-called Islamic terrorist threat to do the same thing in their countries and pass draconian laws that stripped citizens from their rights. And in 2011, you have this law passed here in India that is almost a photocopy of the Patriot Act law of the USA, where now they can incarcerate indefinitely anybody with no charges in the eyes of a judge or in front of a tribunal, and throw the key away and lock you up for decades with no proof of charging you of anything. This authorization exists not only in the West today, but in many of the neocolonial regimes of the global South that are now taking advantage of the whole scheme, Islamophobia scheme, to justify doing the same thing domestically in their country. So Islamophobia today is kind of equivalent to what happened in the war against communism, that now is the new enemy, is the new new discourse used to justify right-wing agendas, imperialist agendas. And if you look at the foundations that are funding a lot of these extreme right leaders in the West today, such as Wilders, Marine Le Pen in France, Wilders in the Netherlands, or right-wing figures in the USA, there's been studies done on this, and we have published in the Islamophobia Journal at Berkeley how the sources of this funding are coming from Zionist foundations. So you see also an alliance, an alliance between Islamophobic discourse with Western power, imperial global designs, in alliance with the Zionist project in the Middle East. So you have this triangle going on, and with regimes in the global South that in fact use Islamophobia, mobilize Islamophobia as a way to align with this global design of the West that is linked to military industrial complex and is linked to imperial global designs of controlling regimes in the third world and aligning them on the side of the West. And so I will say what happened in India is not an exception. You could see this rise of nationalist, fundamentalist regimes emerging in many parts of the world with an Islamophobic agenda in many parts going on right now. And in some parts, you don't need to have necessarily a local non-Muslim fundamentalism. You could have even Muslims doing this to other Muslims. Okay, so you have the coup d'etat in Egypt, for example, as an example of Muslim people now practicing Islamophobia against non-Muslim people. So the problem of Islamophobia is a global discourse today, and it's beyond the issue if you're a Muslim or not anymore, because you will have elites, Westernized elites of Muslim origin or non-Muslim origin, doing this against Muslims in many parts of the world, including the Middle East, where you have regimes led by people who happen to be Muslims themselves and are repressing Muslims and participating of the war on terror and participating of the Islamophobic hysteria that has been constructed over the past 15, 20 years in the West as part of imperial global designs. I will continue tomorrow with more on this, so I just wanted to give a broad panoramic vision of where are these things coming from. So thank you very much.